Okay, how can we make the world a better place? That's something I've always wanted to do. And that's why I became a pro bono professor, a professor who works for the public good. We face serious problems that all of us need to do something about. We will need creativity. People with diverse perspectives can enhance problem solving, and I believe progress can only happen through that kind of diversity. I would like to share with you today my ideas to improve our world. First, we need to steer more people to work on important social problems. Second, we need to communicate our ideas clearly and to teach our students how to do so as well. You may be wondering why we should work on important social problems. Because these problems are growing: environmental threats, income inequality, unsustainable energy policies, corrupted political life, overuse of force, just to name a few. These problems are complex. They have many causes and can create other problems. Let me describe one example. This graph shows two curves. The upper curve with orange squares shows a rapid increase in the percentage of obese American adults since 1960. The lower curve shows the parallel rapid increase in the percentage of adult Americans with diabetes. Both curves show exponential growth. You can argue that the rise in obesity has been one cause of the rise in diabetes. But what caused the rise in obesity? And can we do anything about obesity? No social problem like obesity will have a single simple solution. We will need a variety of answers, such as better school lunches, less added sugar, better product labeling, more exercise programs to reduce obesity and diabetes. One untapped source of problem solvers is at every college, students and teachers. You could expand this list of potential problem solvers to all teachers, all students, all parents, all adults, all of us. I think that developing pro bono professors, teachers who try to solve real problems and who teach their students to do the same, can make a difference. Others have argued that colleges can and should help to solve the world's problems. In 2006, McGonigal and Stark published Planet U, Sustaining the World, Reinventing the University. In their book, they talked about redesigning universities to create sustainable solutions for modern environmental problems. Also, in her 2009 TED Talk, Liz Coleman, the president of Bennington College, described her regret that colleges and universities were not preparing students to solve the big problems of the world. Her college revamped its liberal arts curriculum to focus on making the world a better place, to help students try to make a sustainable and significant difference. I think it's great that Planet U and Bennington will help make the world a better place. I wish every college would embrace these goals so directly, but not every college will. So, how can other teachers work toward the same goal of preparing students to solve the big problems of our world? How can all faculty members become pro bono professors? Let me describe how I came to this point. I began to study cognitive psychology long ago because I wanted to improve education. Cognitive psychologists study memory, thinking, and problem solving, and I plan to apply what I learned to help other people learn better. I could help make the world a better place by improving education. As it turned out, I became a college teacher. My job has given me many chances to apply cognitive psychology, such as teaching statistics to anxious psychology majors. However, it took me a long time to discover how to be a socially responsible college professor. I've worked in an excellent undergraduate psychology department for years. Our research-oriented curriculum trains students in scientific psychology and prepares them to complete an undergraduate research project. When our students go on to graduate school, they report feeling better prepared than their peers. When they go to work in organizations, they become the program evaluators. I was proud of helping design a curriculum that was producing so many successful graduates. However, I was not satisfied. It was not enough to teach students to do research, even research vaguely related to social problems. I wanted to do better. About that time, I learned about my colleague Nicole Caceres and Anthony Graves. Nicole taught an Innocence Project class to communication majors here at UST. She directed students in professional level research activities aimed at a social problem, in this case, investigating the innocence of a man on death row. Their work ultimately freed him from prison. This story really inspired me, and I wasn't the only one. Nicole's success inspired my friend, Rogelio Garcia Contreras, to start a microcredit program here at UST. Elena talked about that earlier. Nicole showed us that faculty members could work on important social problems with undergraduate students. I said, me too. I want to work on important projects with my students. I redirected my students' research projects to focus on socially significant problems. Not all were successful. I had to learn a lot about real problems in order to direct research projects in areas such as torture, conservation decisions, and health behaviors. I created assignments in my classes that address social problems. I steered my students to think about the potential social value of research. They embraced the opportunity, and they surprised me with their ideas. I didn't stop there. I changed more than my teaching and research. I redirected my consulting work to focus on nonprofit educational organizations. I worked on committees that supported student research and social justice issues, such as homelessness and campus healthcare. I learned one big difference between working on research directly related to a real problem and one vaguely related to a real problem. To work directly on a real problem, you had to learn a lot about that problem and its context. Your research obstacles were inconveniently real, not conveniently artificial. The benefits of working on real problems were that you understood society better and you were trying to make society better. Moreover, you were teaching your students that they should work on real problems, just like Nicole and her students taught me to work on real problems. So, my pro bono professor's plan is to have all faculty members work with their students on applied problems that face our society. I have heard objections to this plan. Some think that applied research is a bad idea because it will slow progress. Others think that applied work is impractical for some fields. Still others think that non-elite researchers cannot solve real problems. Let me tell you why they're wrong. First, why doesn't everyone believe that science should be applied and socially useful? You could ask a similar question about every field. Could directing researchers to work on applied projects actually slow progress? The distinction between pure and applied science dates from about the 1940s. Pure science seeks fundamental truths, knowledge for knowledge's sake, and applied science solves practical problems. In this view, fundamental insights from pure science lead to solutions of real problems. Unfortunately, this is not how it happens in the real world. Many scientific breakthroughs began as attempts to solve practical problems. The best example might be Louis Pasteur's work. Pasteur wanted to understand disease, but he also wanted to control anthrax, rabies, and spoiled milk and wine. His applied research, directed at solving these real problems, led to the fundamental understandings of microbiology. Pasteur is just one of many examples. Some in the humanities have similar ideas that look down on work aimed at real problems. For example, art for art's sake. Even movie reviewers have criticized films that included some kind of social commentary, implying that a film's purpose should be to entertain, not to educate about social issues. What about the second objection? That applied work might be impractical for some fields. After all, many fields are not as socially oriented as psychology or communication. How can people in for-profit jobs, for example, work on social problems? Pro bono is short for pro bono publico, meaning for the public good. And the practice is usually associated with lawyers, but it occurs in many professions. The idea is that professionals offer their services free or for reduced fees as a public service. For example, the American Bar Association recommends its members give 50 or more hours a year of pro bono services to people of limited means. To fuel the solution of social problems, we need to extend pro bono service to other fields. For example, some local PR firms are doing this. All of us need to support the society that supports us. So, if we agree that applied research will not slow progress and that a small amount of pro bono research can be a part of every field, the third criticism remains. Can research by non-elite researchers actually make progress towards solving big problems? Of course it can. Our big social problems have many causes and are complex. Cognitive psychologists call problems like these ill-defined problems. As the name suggests, you first have to define an ill-defined problem before you can solve it. We have to understand parts of the problem well enough so we can search for a way to prevent it, to make it better, or to eliminate it. Ill-defined problems often require creative solutions. Solvers must define or invent the form of the problem and then solve it using expertise, perseverance, or a bit of luck. Professors can help with all of these. By teaching about real problems, my students look more often towards solving the pressing needs of our world. They begin to study these problems earlier, and they're more likely to develop the expertise they'll need to solve them sometime later in their career. A great example of this is crowdsourcing, asking many people to solve a problem. Crowdsourcing has an impressive success rate. Historical examples of crowdsourcing include the Longitude Prize of the 1700s, the Oxford English Dictionary of the 1800s, the Mr. Peanut logo of the 1900s, and Wikipedia in this century. Sometimes crowdsourcing results from competition for a prize, as in discovering how to measure longitude or the Netflix Prize. The Netflix Prize, announced in 2006, was a $1 million prize to be awarded for a significantly improved algorithm for recommending films. And it took 3 years, but a team of researchers solved the problem and won the prize. Crowdsourcing has recruited citizen scientists to gather data for a variety of projects in astronomy, linguistics, genetics, bird and butterfly counts, and more. It has worked. Researchers will work for the common good, encouraging a wide variety of researchers and students to try to solve important social problems can work. Not all the attempts will be successful, but we only need some of them to be. Let me give you an example of a student who, in response to an assignment, came up with a great idea to solve one of our world's big problems. Boyan Slap has designed a machine to clean up the giant ocean garbage patches of plastic debris. His idea grew out of a school paper, and he further developed the idea and presented it at TEDx Delft 2012. The Ocean Cleanup Foundation is taking his idea from the drawing board to the ocean. So it's clear we need to train our students in the methods of our field and have them work on real problems. It's also clear that we need to work on real problems at least some of the time. To this list, I will add a third challenge. We cannot accomplish any of this without clear communication. We need to learn to communicate better, and we need to train our students to communicate better too. Why? Because poorly communicated ideas do not gain traction in public discussions. Too often, bad ideas dominate because they're smoothly presented. We all need to be pro bono professors. My journey has been rewarding. I've learned that my teaching is important, but my example is even more important. Let me close with quotes from two famous Americans. The first one is familiar. Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. The second one, from Woody Guthrie, is just as important. There's just one way to save yourself, and that's get together and work and fight for everybody. Thank you.